Welcome back to another episode of the GCN Tech Clinic, where we help and answer and solve your bike-related problems. So if you've got one, leave it for me down there in the comments section, and I'll do my very best to help answer it in a forthcoming episode. As ever, though, let's crack on with the first question this week that comes in from David Hall. Now, David says, "Hey, John, GCN Tech Clinic is always great." Checks in the post, David. Now, David has got a Bianchi Viennarone 7 with a Sora 9-speed groupset. However, looking to get some new wheels, and online, most wheels specify 10 or 11-speed. Can he use those wheels with a 9-speed groupset? Would love to ask the local bike shop, but he's living in Japan, and he says, "John, you know the local the language barrier is hard." Yes, I do, after my trip out there to Japan, but I found everyone out there was really, really helpful. But let's solve this problem then. Well, the good news is, that 9-speed cassette will in fact fit on, well, I think all 10 or 11-speed free hubs out there. I can't think of any reason why it wouldn't. What you will need though is most likely a little spacer, quite often, which goes on first onto the free hub before you put the cassette on, and then before you put that lock ring on. They do come in different thicknesses, so pop along to your local bike shop, and I'm sure even with the best sign language, you can communicate there and get the right size spacer. Enjoy your new wheels. And the next question this week comes in from Play and Teach. Now, Play and Teach has got themselves some 105 28mm ready brake calipers. However, they've had a couple of scary moments where small stones have got caught in between the calipers and the tyre, and in one case, they came to a sudden stop. Do I have any advice, or do I know why this could be? Because they think there should be enough clearance to actually be able to run those tyres. And the tyres are actually Continental GP4000s, and Play and Teach reckons that they are slightly on the larger side. And Play and Teach also wants to know, should they give up on them and try a different 28mm tyre altogether? Now, this one is actually really hard to diagnose without actually seeing the bike and making sure that you have fitted all of the components on there correctly. So it's likely to be actually the brake calipers and the brake shoes. But something here certainly worth considering is the brake bridge, for instance. Is it really close to the tyre? So is it on a really close clearance frame? If so, that could well be providing the problem where the actual material of the brake caliper is too close to the tyre. And yeah, if you are getting little stones, they could well rub on there. So I'd have a look really, because not all frames are gonna be compatible with 28mm tyres, even if you do get those specific calipers. So just have a look over that. As for ditching the GP4000s and trying something else, I guess you could try, but the 4000s, in my experience, in the 28mm, they do measure pretty true to what they say they are. So first up, I'll just check the actual clearances around your fork crown as well as the brake bridge on the rear triangle. And next up, we've got Daniel Jones. Now, Daniel says, "When do you know it's time to add a tooth to the big chainring? Currently using a 52 tooth, but they're thinking they need to go to a 53. Now, Daniel does Ironman triathlons and is in the highest gear possible going downhills and spinning at over 110 RPM. On the flat, generally in the fourth smallest cog on the cassette, would I need to change the small chainring too?" Right then, Daniel, the mere fact you're answering this question, I reckon you're ready for it. Especially, like you say, you're actually spinning out at quite a high cadence on those descents. And by going up to a 53 tooth chainring, it is gonna give you just a little bit of a smoother ride, I guess, on those descents. And also on the flat, this means that you could probably be in the fifth sprocket from the end, and therefore probably have a smoother chain line than in the fourth, therefore giving you possibly half a watt or a watt saving, something like that. As for replacing the inner chainring at the same time, I know lots of people out there would recommend it. So quite often on chainrings, it will say, certainly on Shimano, 53-39 on there and things like that. And people will say replace them in pairs because the shifting ramps and pins are designed in such a way. However, that's not strictly necessary. I've done it, certainly mixing and matching chainrings. Okay, the shifting performance maybe isn't absolutely the best it could be, but it's still certainly adequate. Plus, you've got to think about how often you actually change chainrings to start with. Okay, next question comes in from Matt Ryan. Now, Matt says that they picked up a Felt B16 as a stepping stone into triathlon, but the internally routed cables seem to rattle inside of the frame. Any ideas on the best way to fix it? It's a minor annoyance, but I like it when everything is just right. Man after my own heart there, because, well, yeah, I hate it when a bike rattles. And also, I do forgive you for taking part in triathlon. There we are. Only joking. But what about that annoying rattle then? Well, first up, find out exactly which tube it's coming in, probably in your top tube or your down tube. Remove likely your bottom bracket or at least certainly your chain set or your seat post. Isolate that cable, but how are we gonna do that? Get yourself some bubble wrap. Yep, that's right. So it's lightweight, it's not gonna trap water, it's not gonna hold it or anything like that. And you can wedge it in place. And if you're lucky, you can kind of wedge it so that your cables are away from the actual internal of the frame tubes, therefore preventing that rattle. It's something I've done in the past before on one of my own bikes, and it is a fail-safe solution. Yes. Okay, next up is Arter, and Arter says, "Hi John, great show, I watch it every week." Again, another check in the post. I have a 2015 Cannondale Super 6 with SRAM Red and an 1128 cassette. Planning to buy a new and lighter pair of wheels to use on uphill training and races. I read that the rear derailleur does not work with an 1132 cassette. Is that right? Do you think it could work with an 1130? What should I do? Thanks a lot, cheers from Brazil. Brazil, hey? Always wanted to visit. Right, okay, what about that then? Well, I'm pretty sure that a 32-tooth cassette won't be accommodated unless you're using one of the Y-Fly model rear derailleurs. But again, I'm not exactly 100% sure on that one. So if you do though, you're likely to have to play around with that B-tension screw to actually basically adjust where the upper pulley wheel sits in relation to the cassette sprockets, and you're gonna wanna actually drop that down a little bit by using that screw. But you would definitely be able to use a 30-tooth cassette on there, because a friend of mine, he's done exactly that, and he used a Shimano cassette, believe it or not, to get the compatibility. But yeah, it's very likely, whatever you do, you are gonna need to play around with that B-tension screw, so just be aware of that to get perfect shifting, and good luck. Next up is Casey Rutledge. Now, Casey has got a problem with their bike that the front forks dropouts were painted, and well, the paint has begun to crack and fall off. How do they stop it from progressing up the fork? Right then, Casey, paint problems, never good. Now, I consulted with my colleague Doddy over on GMBM for this, and luckily we agreed. Best thing to do, get yourself some acetone or an alcohol swab, clean up those dropouts and where the paint has been affected really, really well, and then get yourself some clear nail varnish and then simply paint it on there to kind of build a bridge in between the current paint and the stuff that's been missing. Therefore, that should seal it and prevent any paint from flaking further up your forks. Next up is Lau here, who says they really enjoy watching the show. How safe is it to run SRAM ETAP rim brake shifters using a TRP disc brake caliper on a disc frame? Will the cable pull destroy the frame? Right, I've checked this one out. Now, TRP actually lists all of their cable operated disc calipers as being compatible with all cable shifters out there or cable brake levers on the market, so you will be safe with that. As for it destroying your frame with a cable pull, no, no danger of that, because the inner cable is going to be running through an outer cable. So obviously that outer cable, that stays fixed in place, and it's simply the inner cable which travels through it. Next up, Stephen Moore. Now, Stephen says they've got a pair of CX18 rims on Campag record hubs for a vintage Gazelle build. Keen to see this one. Will the tubulars still be good if re-glued? They look new, with no signs of degrading or perishing. They're 25 years old, but had very little use. Stephen, a fellow vintage tech lover. I like this. And then, well, in fact, Eddie Merckx, he used to have a cellar full of old tubular tires that he had maturing. But like anything, after a little bit of time, they could well go off in effect. But like you say, the rubber looks good. They look to be new almost, but something to consider here with old tubulars, and this is a problem I've ran into myself, is the base tape pulling away from the actual carcass of the tubular. So a way of discovering if that's gonna happen is by mounting those tubulars without any glue on onto a pair of tubular rims and pump them up to their maximum PSI, and then inspect that base tape to make sure it's still fully adhered onto the actual carcass. If it's not, something I've used in the past to actually re-stick it onto the carcass is some latex-based adhesive. It seems to do the trick all right. A lot of people, they recommend using tubular cement, so your tub glue, for instance, but I find that gets a little bit too hard, and also it tends to create just a bit of extra bulging, really, not giving you the super smooth ride of tubular tires. So give that one a go and see how you get on. Plus, I'm desperate to see that vintage Gazelle build. Absolutely love them. Right, final question this week comes in from Simon Gard. John, I've got a Vitus Energy cross bike with SRAM 1x. The frame has internal cable routing, but being 1x, I have two ports on the bike which are filling up with mud. Contacted Vitus, they don't do blanks. Do you have any ideas or know where I can buy them? Right, Simon, nice little bike you've got there by the sounds of it, and great that you're going out and getting nice and muddy. Right, easiest solution here, clean up around those areas and simply put some frame protector on there, or insulation tape, gaffer tape, anything like that. All right, it's not gonna look the most elegant, but well, it's a cyclocross bike, so it's getting covered in mud anyway. It's gonna stop mud getting in there. Something the friend of mine does, they actually fill those holes with silicone sealant. So the sort of thing which you put around the edge of a bath or shower, something like that. Just be careful though, you don't put too much in there and it goes all down inside the frame. You wanna be able to pick it off in the case that you do go back to a 2x setup. Last one, a little bit extreme perhaps, but well, I like to throw them out there. If you've got a friend or know someone who has a 3D printer, maybe, just maybe, they could make you something fancy to go in there. But again, that's going to take quite a bit of planning and really accurate measuring, in fact. So personally, I'd probably just go for that simple, elegant, well, maybe not that elegant, but tape solution. Right, there we are. This week's Tech Clinic done and dusted. But remember, if you've got yourself a technical problem, get involved down there in the comments section. Also, if you've got a solution for one of these problems too, why don't you help them out? A friend in need is a friend indeed. Right, also don't forget to like and share this video with your friends. Don't forget too, to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. And now for another great video, how about this week's Monday Maintenance, just down here.